Good evening, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to tonight's Family Connection Workshop on the Multiple Pathways for High School Learners in VB Schools. My name is Leslie Riccio, and I'm a Family Outreach Representative with the Office of Family and Community Engagement. I will be the facilitator for tonight's session, where we will learn about options for funding college. This session will include information on how to complete the FAFSA form, scholarship websites, and tips on navigating the college application process. There will also be information specific to military families, including dependent children using a parent's transferred GI Bill, specifics regarding the Yellow Ribbon Program, military scholarships, benefits for military students, and in-state tuition rules unique to military families. Let's welcome our panelists. First, we have Adria Phillips, Program Specialist with the Access College Foundation. Next, we have Rebecca Davila, Military Connected School Counselor from the Office of Student Support Services with VB Schools. I would also like to introduce our two interpreters, Stacy Lowe and Kim Fox. Thank you all for being here. Tonight, we're going to hear a presentation from each panelist, followed by a question and answer session using the questions that were submitted for tonight's event. Throughout the presentation, we will also be putting a link to a Google form in the chat. Should you have a question come up that is not answered in the presentation, please use this form to submit the question, and either Mrs. Phillips or Mrs. Davila will follow up with you via email. You can also use this form to simply request a general follow-up from either panelist. I'm now going to turn it over to Mrs. Phillips to begin her presentation from the Access College Foundation. Mrs. Phillips?
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here tonight. Again, I am Mrs. Phillips. I'm with Access College Foundation. We are in your high schools, in the public high schools in Virginia Beach. You can find an Access advisor in each one. And tonight, we are going to do a brief overview of the financial aid process. I will provide the link to our website at the end and information on how to contact your student's advisor at their school at the end of the presentation. So again, welcome everyone. Let's get started.
Mrs. Phillips, excuse me, you're not quite in presenter view. We can see your slide, your next slide, and your notes.
Okay.
If you want to get out and get back in, that's okay. It happens sometimes. No worries.
Yep, let me get that corrected.
While she's doing that, I will put that link in the chat that I mentioned. If you want to request a follow-up from either of our panelists tonight, or if you want to ask a question that doesn't happen to get answered, or if you submitted a question that we didn't get a chance to get to, this is a good place to put it, and they'll follow back up with you via email after the fact. So here comes that form. Perfect, Ms. Phillips, that looks great.
Great. Let me see. How about now?
Yep.
Perfect.
Everything looks good.
All right, great. So we'll continue on. So how to apply for student financial aid. Completing the FAFSA is the only way to get government and institutional assistance to pay college costs. Both the student and a parent need an FSA ID, and that can be obtained at fsaid.ed.gov so that you and a parent can sign your FAFSA electronically when it's completed. To set up an FSA ID, some basic information will be needed for both the student and the parent. The following is needed: an email address. The parent and student's email address has to be different. Social security numbers, birthdays, full legal name as it is on your social security card, and address are needed to set up the FSA IDs. To file the FAFSA, students and parents will need the basic information they use to set up for their IDs, and they will be using their 2020 taxes. Parents will need their 2020 tax return, 2020 W-2s, as well as bank account estimates and asset estimates to fill out the FAFSA form. Students will need the exact same information, especially if they worked in 2020 and filed a tax return. Students will also need to know what colleges they want to send the FAFSA form to. On the FAFSA, you can list up to 10 colleges. You can list a college on the form even if you have not applied yet. So even if you're considering a college, you can list that on your form. And you would be surprised how many errors are made on FAFSAs each year, because an error can delay an award for up to 6 weeks. Please reach out to us for help. The most common errors are not accurately reporting your social security number and the name as it is on your social security card. While most students are considered dependent and are required to include parent information, if any of the following applies to the student, then the student may be deemed independent and not require parent information on the FAFSA. Please consult with your college financial aid office if you think you may fit one of these categories. Now, much of the, those are losing my slide here. Much of this presentation has been about the FAFSA because it is the form that all students and parents complete. However, it is also helpful to understand the process that occurs after the FAFSA is submitted. The FAFSA will cause the federal processor to send a student aid report, or SAR, to you and all colleges you listed on your FAFSA. The SAR will contain comments regarding any corrections requested and other notes. The most important information on your SAR is your expected family contribution or EFC number. The financial aid process diagram illustrates the flow of information and decisions that will occur. Notice that it all begins with the FAFSA, which generates your student aid report, which is sent to both you and the colleges you listed on your FAFSA. The SAR contains your expected family contribution, which the colleges use to determine the types of aid for which you qualify to help pay your college costs. The colleges to which you have been accepted and which were listed on your FAFSA will then send you a financial aid award letter. Keep in mind that the purpose of financial aid is to help you meet college costs. Your aid offer may not pay all costs. The Department of Education has teamed up with the IRS to make sure that tax information on both the FAFSA and the tax return match. Generally, when you file your FAFSA as a will file, you will be flagged for verification. When filing the FAFSA with your 2020 taxes, you will have an option to link directly to the IRS using the DRT or data retrieval tool. You may also be required to submit a tax transcript, which can be acquired either online, over the phone, or by faxing in the transcript request form. And we have provided here the online address to do so. Then what? Don't forget to accept the money. They don't automatically assume that your student wants every single aspect of their financial aid package. Most colleges have a deadline by which you must accept your award, and colleges often have other steps for you to take, which may include signing loan promissory notes, completing loan counseling, completing verification documentation, and completing other institutional forms. Failure to follow through with any of those requirements can result in the loss of financial aid. And we certainly don't want that. Get to know your financial aid administrator. They can help with answering questions, special circumstances, or any concerns you may have. And you may have some type of circumstances and that you're unsure of. Please feel free to reach out to us. Here we have a QR code and our website where you can find every advisor throughout Southampton Roads, Northampton County, and their contact information. So feel free to reach out to your access advisor to get help with filing the FAFSA and other college assistance that is needed. Thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it, and we'll take questions at the end.
Thank you, Mrs. Phillips. I'm now gonna ask you the questions that came in for you this evening.
Perfect.
So the first question that came in was, how do I gain a scholarship and what other ways can I pay for college?
So that's a very good question. There are a lot of scholarship websites and scholarship resources available to our students here in VB. We'll start with Scholarship Central, which you can find, students can find directly on their high school's website and on VB School's website. There is a link there for Scholarship Central.
Great. Okay, are FAFSA loan amounts determined by the past 3 years of household income?
So FAFSA loan amounts, there are different loans that students and parents will qualify for through filing their FAFSA, and they're federal loans. Federal loans often do not require any type of credit check or any co-signers. So by filing the FAFSA, you may be eligible for some federal loans, which are beneficial because typically they have the lowest interest rates. And again, they don't have that credit history or the need for a co-signer.
Awesome. And how does the 529 prepaid plan work in Virginia? Once the student is ready to go to college, how does the family access that money?
So they will get with their 529 account, the people that hold that, whether it's a PrePEP or 529 college savings plan, and they will request the money to be sent to the college that the student will be attending. So they will request the amount that they need sent, and the money goes directly to the student's account at the college. And then that student, when they register for classes, that money will be there for them to utilize.
Awesome, thank you. This question asks, where can we find grant information applicable for our students?
So grants and scholarships are two different things. So grants can be funded by the federal government, the state government, and your college. By filing the FAFSA form, they will have your award package will state if you qualify for any grants. When we file a FAFSA for a student and parent and assist them in filing, when we get that EFC number, it's easy for us to tell what you may see from the colleges you have selected in an award letter. So in that financial aid package, scholarships come in all types, all forms. And again, we have that VB Scholarship Central, but there are many, many, many scholarship websites out there. I can say searching for scholarships and completing them is like a part-time job. So it takes a lot of determination and work, but it does pay off. And you have to make sure you're using safe websites, as well as possibly set up a separate email for joining those types of scholarship websites, like Moolah Spot or scholarships.com. And many, Going Merry is a big one that VB Schools uses as well.
Perfect, thank you. And the last question I have for you asks, are there considerations for scholarships or grants when a family has two freshmen applying for college tuition assistance at the same time?
Yes, so when you file a FAFSA and you have two, your EFC, that expected family contribution, gets cut in half. So when that's cut in half, the family sees, the colleges see that the family has a higher need because there are two students in college at the same time. So they may be eligible for more need-based scholarships and or more need-based aid.
Perfect. That is the last question I have for you tonight, Mrs. Phillips. Thank you so much. In just a moment, I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Davila to share information specific to the military connected community. But let's give her just a minute to pull up her presentation and for our interpreters to switch places if they're ready to. We'll find out. So Mrs. Davila, take your time and feel free to get your screen share ready. And meanwhile, I'm going to put the link in the chat again for the Google form if you would like to request that Mrs. Phillips or Mrs. Davila follow up with you via email or if you have a question to ask. That looks great, Mrs. Davila. So whenever you're, actually, let's take just a moment and swap the interpreters if you all don't mind, just one second. like to make sure we're not overworking anybody. So give us 1 second. We'll switch out the interpreters and then we'll get started. Thank you for your patience. Okay. Looks like we're good to go now. All right, go ahead, Mrs. Davila, whenever you're ready.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. I am Rebecca Davila, the Virginia Beach City Public Schools Military Connected School Counselor for the division. Currently, I service all VBCPS schools by providing resources and assisting the military dependent student and families. As a Navy veteran, an active duty Marine spouse with 3 children, I'm honored to be serving in this role and providing this presentation tonight. A popular question I receive often over the years is, how do I transfer my GI Bill to my child? Short answer, every eligible active duty personnel must apply via the MilConnect website. So if you have your phones out throughout my presentation, you can use the QR codes in the presentation that I have on the majority of the slides. So the one QR code there is for the MilConnect website. The post 9/11 GI Bill also, MilConnect website. So it'll show you here that for the post 9/11, you need to complete 6 years of active duty service. You also need to add 4 years of service, totaling 10 years before you can transfer your GI Bill to a dependent. Also, you need to have your eligible dependents in DEERS. And then you need to apply, of course, and then be approved. That is the big point right there, to make sure that you are approved, because not every active duty member is approved. As a former education counselor for active duty service members, I highly suggest to submit the request once eligible and then review and print your approval letter, because sometimes the online version has been lost. Also, to go back to the MilConnect website, it is beneficial to make sure that you are approved, and if there's any recommendations that you may need to change or add something so you can be approved. For the post 9/11 GI Bill benefits, also known as Chapter 33, most people wonder, what can you actually get? There's quite a few things, as you can see here. You have the in-state tuition and fees. And if you qualify for the maximum benefit, the VA cost will pay for the in-state tuition and fees, which is around $26,000 currently for this year. Each year, it does change. The VA caps the rates for private and foreign schools and updates those rates each year, which can be viewed online. Money for housing. If you're in school more than half time, monthly housing allowance on the cost of living where your school is located. Students can receive up to $1,000 per school year via stipend. Money to help you move from a rural area to go to school. You may qualify for this one-time payment of $500 if you live in a country, in a county with 6 or few people per square mile, and you're either moving at least 500 miles to go to school or have no other option but to fly by plane to get to your school. So not this area, but if you PCS and move to a rural area, this may be helpful for a for a dependent. The VA and educational benefits. Of course, there are 2 other main GI Bill benefits that some people may not know about, which is DEA and the Frye Scholarship. The DEA, which stands for the Survivor and Dependents Educational Assistance Program, and the Frye Scholarship, which is regularly called, is the Marine Gunnery Sergeant John David Frye Scholarship. The Survivors Independence Educational Assistance, DEA, program offers education and training to qualified dependents of veterans who are permanently and totally disabled because of a service-related condition, or who died while on active duty, or as a result of a service-related condition. Benefits, one asks, monthly education payments and specific amounts are directly sent to the student. The current monthly payment for full-time training is $1,265 and does change, so I advise to view the VA payment rate for this benefit. For the FRI scholarship, active duty service members for the dependents, of course, would be, is if the active duty service members died in the line of duty on or after September 11th, 2001, or members of the selected reserves who died from a service-connected disability on or after September 11th, 2001. And then I do have the web link at the bottom if you would like to review those further if you're eligible. For the FRI benefits, it's almost just like Chapter 33, the GI Bill, because you have the benefits for the education and training, you get money for tuition, money for housing, and money for books and supplies. The number one question also is the yellow ribbon. Everybody hears about it. And if you're not, this is the great benefit with the GI Bill. The very fortunate military dependents may feel like they won the 1 million jackpot if they are yellow ribbon participants and recipients. FRI scholarship recipients are eligible for post 9/11 and dependents of the post 9/11 GI Bill at the 100% level are awarded anywhere from 1 to 36 months of benefits may be eligible for the Yellow Ribbon program. Yellow Ribbon recipients are very fortunate as they may attend expensive colleges or university that they may not have even thought of, and possibly not have to pay any out-of-pocket expenses depending on the overall tuition and fees of the particular school. How? Well, the Yellow Ribbon benefits, consider it like a scholarship or a grant. The VA will match the contribution that the school agrees to pay. However, not every student will receive a scholarship, and some schools only offer a small amount, maybe $1,000, while some offer $20,000 for a few students, while other schools may offer to pay the remaining amount of tuition. So if you think of a school that you were looking at and considering but didn't think because it's so expensive, consider it and see if they're a Yellow Ribbon participant. Some schools do not participate in the Yellow Ribbon program, so I always recommend reviewing the VA website on participating schools, which I've given the QR code here. The Yellow Ribbon program is geared to lower the tuition and fees for students attending expensive private colleges, foreign universities, or public schools as non-residents. The Yellow Ribbon is not awarded for students attending a public nonprofit school at the in-state tuition rate, as the GI Bill will pay the in-state tuition directly to the school based on the number of GI Bill months awarded to the student and the number of credits that they're enrolled in. Students should also inquire with the school they wish to apply to see if the program is available for the year and how many applicants are awarded for the program they are interested in pursuing. Therefore, it is highly recommended to apply early to increase the chances of receiving the Yellow Ribbon, because I've heard some, there's only 3 or 4 participants that can actually receive the Yellow Ribbon at one program for one school. And that one participant has it for the next 4 years. So now there's only 3 participants that receive it. If you qualify, your school will contribute a certain amount towards your extra tuition and fees through a grant, scholarship, or similar program. So again, try and see if you can get the Yellow Ribbon. So do not discount those expensive 4-year colleges as some I've seen have no cost payments at all. The GI Bill comparison tool. I love recommending this great VA resource tool. It's highly recommended. This is a search tool to determine the cost analysis of private versus public schools and compares in-state versus out-of-state schools or programs. Students can gain a better understanding of the programs offered at a school and whether a school offers VA resources like Yellow Ribbon or additional support for military dependents like a military office that can help the financial aid part. The GI Bill also provides details such as how many students are enrolled and whether the school is flagged due to the number of complaints or VA violations. I usually like to click on the GI Bill comparison tool to discount the schools that have too many violations because those are the red warning flag universities and some of those have actually been shut down. Survivors, if you can see here on the slide, you can actually select depending on which benefit you're eligible for, post 9/11 GI Bill, for the dependents if you have the DEA, and or if you're a FRI participant. And based on the new policy, I do want to also let you know, if you use DA after August 1st, 2018, you will receive decreased amount of 36 months vice the 46 months of education benefits. Again, policies change often, so I say always review the policies on the VA websites. Individuals who first used the DA prior to August 1st qualified for a maximum of 45 months. Again, on this slide here, this one just shows you that you can select the FRI scholarship, which is at the 100% level. If you're wondering what the other percentage level is, that's based on the amount of time somebody served and if they completed their full contract, which then would be the 36 months at the 100% level that service members want to gain and then transfer to their dependents. And also it should be noted now that the FRI scholarship, you can use the Yellow Ribbon. So they're eligible for the Yellow Ribbon if they are a FRI scholarship recipient. This website here on this page, I have two websites that I highly recommend also. It discusses, not everybody's ready to go to college. So some may want to do on-the-job training or apprenticeships. You don't have to use your benefits, all of them, if you have the FRI or the GI Bill to go to a four-year university. You can use it to go to an apprenticeship program. And this, the top one here at the apprenticeship.gov, those have select programs that will help you if you want to learn how to do welding or plumbing, hands-on positions that our country desperately needs. The VA Department of Veteran Affairs, I worked, I've been affiliated with them, but I highly recommend, and I've even used the GI Bill for myself under my own veteran status. So in using and researching all of this, I've always found it best to call the number and speak to the representatives and look at the website, but there's also Ask VA, and they can help you by submitting an online question. And then you also have VA reps at education offices for the Marine Corps, the Army as well, or the Navy personnel can call the educational office since they've been virtual now. Higher Education Opportunity Act. It's a great one because it does not charge military spouses or dependent children more than the in-state tuition rate, so long as the service member is on active duty for more than 30 days and is stationed in the state of the relevant public college area for the state, they will get the in-state rate. The law also provides that once a student begins paying the in-state tuition rate, that student will pay that rate for as long as he or she is continuously enrolled in the institution. So if somebody moves here to Virginia and they're on active duty orders for at least those 30 days, then your dependent can receive the in-state rate. All dependents of active duty military service members stationed in Virginia are eligible for in-state college tuition rates, even if the family PCS while the student is in school. So I know many come here, they love the education for Virginia. They're stationed here, their high school dependent then goes to college. They can have the in-state rate, and then the remaining family members can PCS to another state. No member or dependent will be required to change their official residency to Virginia from another state to receive the in-state tuition rates as long as the student remains enrolled in school. The in-state tuition rates remain even if a student transfers between two Virginia schools. I do recommend viewing the VA state education rules for your home of record or current domicile based on orders. So where you enlisted and the service member enlisted from their home of record. I would review the state college or state university official websites. You will find that in most cases, these sites will have specific information on the veteran education assistance programs offered in that state and how to begin the process. Each state does offer various levels of benefits: Texas, California, Illinois, Florida, even Virginia offers many great rates for dependents, sometimes even free for the full 4 years. It just depends on the states. These programs are usually administered through the state departments of higher education and the Office of Veteran Affairs. The availability of these programs will vary widely, like I said, from state to state. Veterans and/or their dependents should contact not only their State Department of Veteran Education, but also the Office of Veteran Affairs for details on financial aid programs for which they may be eligible. Because again, each of the rules and regulations are different, and sometimes they change over the years, just like the VA. Other states offer free or reduced tuition for the dependents of military. Again, California, even Alabama, offers such of these programs, and they do change based on legislation or budget issues as well. The Virginia Military Survivors and Dependents Education Program, VMSDEP, is a program that provides education benefits to spouses and children of military service members killed, missing in action, taken prisoner, or who became totally and permanently disabled, or at least 90% permanently disabled as a result of military service in armed conflict. Military service includes service in the U.S. Armed Forces, United States Armed Forces, the Reserves, or the National Guard. Armed conflict includes military operations against terrorism, or as a result of a terrorist act, a peacekeeping mission, or any armed conflict. You can call or email them. I actually called them today. The number does work. It is up to date. And there is certain regulations and they will assist you. The one thing is you have to be a resident for 5 years for Virginia to qualify for this. So again, 5 years, and it only has to be at least one type of document. So taxes, income, 5 years of all of income, 5 years of all of taxes, something that shows a continuation that you were not a resident at another state. Scholarship opportunities, because not everybody's eligible for the GI Bill benefit. Maybe when you retired or you were not in for 10 years and you couldn't transfer your GI Bill, or thankfully you were not injured then you may not qualify for some of those benefits, or you're not a resident here for 5 years. So there are scholarship opportunities. Again, FAFSA is great. And I put the FAFSA website here because, and the QR code to access, as it mentions all of these programs on their website. They also have the Department of Education grant. That is for a parent or guardian who died as a result of military service in Iraq or Afghanistan after the events of 9/11. You may be eligible for Ed grant funds, but to determine your eligibility, I would visit their website and then see if you apply and are eligible. The VSOs are also veteran service organizations, your typical ones that most people think of is Disabled American Veterans, the American Legion, Military Order of Purple Heart, Navy Marine Corps Relief Society, Paralyzed Veterans of America, Veterans of Foreign Wars, and Vietnam Veterans of America. Some of those VSOs that if you're eligible, your dependents can receive scholarships. You also have Reserve Officers Training Corps scholarships, ROT scholarships, and military academies. That's for anybody. You don't have to be military affiliated or a dependent. And it is something that if you have good grades and you've taken the right courses, I would highly suggest applying to a military academy and seeing if you're eligible for an ROTC scholarship. And those processes are different for each of the branches. The Fisher House Scholarship, I would apply for that. That's a great one. That opens up here December 13th, here next month. And I also wanted everybody to realize the Fisher House Scholarship is because you can find scholarship for family that are related to the military affiliated. So active, reserve, retired, and veterans as well. The Tragedy Assistance Program for Survivor, TAPS, offers scholarships and has a scholarship finder, which is great as well because it's a different category. They have service members who passed away in combat and theater in the line of duty while on active duty, from a service-connected injury or illness on active duty, or on active duty but not in the line of duty. And from a service-connected injury or illness, retiree or veteran status, and a non-service-connected who is retiree or veteran. So I would look at this website if you've lost, unfortunately, you've lost your service member, your guardian or parent, and this is a website that can assist you with additional resources as well. The Fallen Patriots is for dependent children, whether natural, by marriage, or adoption, who have lost a parent in the line of military duty during combat or peacetime. All branches, including the Coast Guard and all components, active, reserve, and guard, are covered. This organization mission is to provide college scholarships and educational counseling to the children of military personnel who have passed away in the line of duty. The main goal is to bridge the gap in funding between the available sources of grants and scholarships, the VA Chapter 33, 35, federal, state, local, and private grants, and the total cost of college. So it kind of helps to bridge that gap. I do suggest calling and providing the necessary documents that they require, and they said that they would assist you. There are some particular documents that they would need, though, a copy of the casualty report, the DD 1300 or the DD 214, along with death and birth certificates, class schedule, the bursar statement, and the proof of your VA benefits for your children under 18, the transcript with GPA and documents of expensive if it's applicable to the situation. Scholarship Central. I do suggest the Scholarship Central on Virginia Beach City Public Schools. They do try and maintain that and update it as often. And there's a plethora of resources on there for the students. In addition, I would do a broad research for scholarships as well. There are many opportunities for particular branches of the military. So you can change the scope in your research by looking for the branch if you're a dependent of a Marine versus Navy versus Coast Guard. Also the years of service that your parent or has served. So if somebody even served in World War II, you could, and you're a family member, you could maybe get a scholarship. Or if somebody is part of a VSO, if they served in Iraq or if they served in Vietnam, depending on the time span, their operations that they had, as well as their job, if they served on a sub or a ship. So some of the scholarships are very specific. So talking with your guardian, if there's dependents out there listening to this, I would talk to your parents or guardians and see and learn a little bit about them to see what you might be able to apply for during your search. Also duty stations, there's particular duty stations, maybe they were stationed in Guam or Okinawa or somewhere here stateside, then you can look for a particular duty station. Any affiliations that they're a part of with organizations, even on base, they offer those. The commissary even offers scholarships. So there is a search button that is utilized and updated as well with lots of different resources and articles that you can use, which is College Recon. It just takes the diligence to submit the required paperwork though, and completing the process to earn a scholarship or grant for college and the apprenticeship programs. So I do recommend, even when you start the search, it might seem overwhelming, but if you can just kind of narrow it down and then really stick to the one or two that you want to apply, but do try and apply to as many scholarships as you can or grants that you might be eligible for. In closing, I want to thank everybody for being here tonight and taking the time to listen to this presentation. If you have any additional questions, I can be reached via email. I have the QR code for the Virginia Beach City Public Schools page. They have a site for military. And so I believe Leslie has some questions for me.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Davila. I do have some questions. The first one that came in for you, you addressed it somewhat, but maybe you could just reiterate the information. Which Virginia colleges offer the most robust yellow ribbon program?
I love hearing that one. So the most robust, I always like to say that's still dependent on the various variables, because what may be robust for one school is different for another, depending on what program you actually apply for. So an art major going to one school may not like the engineer program at another school. So I still say, even though you want to look for the best yellow ribbon program, it's always best to keep in mind, what school do you actually want to attend and what program does the dependent really want? Because you don't want to be an engineer if that's not what you want. I do suggest looking at the VA has a search button on the GI Bill comparison tool, and you can see there's a breakdown of lists, private versus public, as well as for-profit versus nonprofit. There are a few of the websites with the links where it will show you that like William and Mary, you can attend there. Well, if you go to the Wesley College, it changes. So that's just a really tricky question to answer with an answer like that.
Thank you. This question came in a couple different times. They would like to know, where can we find the free funding application for military parents who are 100% disabled? And is it true that students can attend in-state college for free if they do have military parents who are 100% disabled?
So yes, if they are 100%, now it has to be 100% totally disabled. And so that's a different type of category when you go from 90 to 100%. And it also needs to be static for the 90%. So just making sure when I spoke with the representatives today and before looking at it, you have to show that either with your benefits letter from the VA and then also documentation that you're not going to get a decrease in your rating. And so that it's static and there's no pending exams. And then there was a two-part question. What was that?
Actually, I think you got it. I think you got it all. That was great. Thank you. Can you explain the CHOICE Act and how it could benefit military dependents in VB schools?
So the CHOICE Act, now not every state follows it and some schools may not, but the majority of the states have come online with allowing in-state tuition for dependents of active duty military. They may not make you wait for a year if to show that you're a resident compared to some others, and then make you switch your residency as well. But it's always best to talk to the college in the state that you're looking. And it can be dependent, because I know a lot of us, I still have a Hawaii license. I need to go to the DMV. My husband from New York, I mean, and then are you here? Somebody still has their address in Florida. And so, I mean, there's many different ties to various states. So they sometimes will allow you to have in-state rates.
Great. And this question kind of relates to that too. And it said that my daughter is applying to a school that bases in-state versus out-of-state tuition for the post 9/11 GI Bill on the residence of the applicant. If our family moves during her 4 years at college, will her residency status change as a result?
No, it's not. So like I mentioned also, most of the states, especially Virginia, if you PCS or move while your child is in school, they maintain that residency. So once you start school with an in-state tuition, you maintain that unless you disenroll or there's a long lapse in your education.
Great, thank you. And then one last question. And this talks about the GI Bill, the information on the website. And this person said that it seems to be very generic. And what's the best way to figure out the process and to be totally prepared? And should parents and students expect to have an interview or meeting with financial counselors for each school? Or are there some common things all schools require to apply to use the GI Bill benefits?
Okay. So I always suggest calling. I've called numerous times. There are some longer wait times than others. And it's always been recommended too is to review the scenario-based questions on the VA. That gives a more refined answers because it's written actually by representatives for education benefits. It's not a call center that doesn't have the base knowledge compared to the people that are writing the answers. Because you know, as a military, if it's written, then they have to abide by it. So I've always been told if you have a very specific question, you can update and then also submit your documents. Now through the new portal, it's called Ask VA, and you can create a login. I do suggest that because then you can submit your personal questions and then you'll have your answers written back from a VA representative in writing with the steps. And then also it is recommended that you call and talk with the college representatives. I usually suggest asking if they have a military office. The GI Bill comparison tool for a particular college will tell you if they do or do not have a military office representatives. Some are more familiar with military than other small colleges. And of course, if you are eligible for any of the benefits, you do actually have to apply. So even though the benefits were transferred to you, there is an online application that you have to apply as a dependent and then be approved so you can have your official letter saying that you are a recipient of the GI Bill, and it'll tell you how many months you have awarded to you, which could change if you your parents think that your grades are lower and they take some of those months away.
Great. Thank you so much. If you could stop sharing your screen, that would be great. That wraps up our questions that we have time for tonight. As a reminder, I've been putting a link in the chat throughout that goes to a Google form. If you would like to request a follow-up from one of our panelists tonight, would be how you would do it. I would like to thank our panelists and our interpreters for their time, expertise, and thoughtful responses. And I would also like to thank the VBCPS community for submitting these questions and taking the time to be here with us virtually this evening. As a reminder, these sessions are recorded and will be available on vbschools.com. Thank you again so much for coming. We hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving break. Take care, everybody.
Bye.